I'm Jeffrey Bloom. I'm the Associate Dean for Academics and Faculty Affairs. I'm a professor of data science here at the School of Data Science at the University of Virginia. And by trade, I'm a biostatistician. So I have two major roles here. One is my administrative role, and one is my faculty role. And I think of them as separate. So on the administrative side, I'm responsible for helping produce in the academic side of the school and making sure it runs smoothly so that people can do what they need to do to educate and to do research and to have good faculty lives here. On the faculty side, I think of myself, and I am a researcher. I have students, I teach, and I'm engaged in the traditional faculty life in that sense, just a little bit less. So I do a heavy amount of administration, and then I do the remainder. I'm teaching one course a year, and I'm doing research on several projects as we go through. Actually, interesting story. I thought I was going to do international relations and psychology, but international relations didn't really like me, and neither did psychology. So I've had a couple stat courses and found I really love that material. And so I went to do that. And from there, I had some internships. I had two summer internships at a company called the Genetics Institute. I got my first exposure to clinical trials and what statisticians do and how they help develop drugs for people. And so went to graduate school in biostatistics, and then was had a faculty appointment at Brown University and then Vanderbilt, and then came here for data science. I have two areas that I think of when I think about my research. So I have collaborative research and I have methodological research. They are separate and connected, so they have different goals. So the methodological research is to push the knowledge base in biostatistics, statistics, in data science, and I'll tell you a little bit about what I do there, forward. And then the collaborative research is to use those tools to do good on the science side, to push science forward. And for me personally, that's mostly in biomedicine. And in particular, it would be in clinical trials, in areas of radiology, for screening, for lung cancer screening or different types of screening. And on the methods side, I study the foundations of statistics. So how do you know what information is in the data, and how do you report that with some certainty? So how much evidence is there about a particular hypothesis or not? And I study prediction models. So those are the two areas. I've done a lot of work in clinical trials. I'm doing a little bit less of that work now. The prediction modeling is focused also in two areas. One is in how we handle missing data with prediction models, which is an important piece. Largely because the tools that we use in statistics to handle missing data that everyone's adopted in machine learning are not necessarily the best tools for handling them. And so I'm interested in how do you get good answers when you're missing a lot of data, and what does it mean to get a good answer on a prediction side? Then on the prediction modeling side, my lab, the students I work with, are trying to marry a little bit the ideas and intuition that you get when you build a statistical model with the ideas and intuition that you get when you build a machine learning or an algorithmic model. And they are both trying to end up eventually to do similar things. And the idea is, how do you connect these? And should they be connected? So right now they're pretty divergent, and people are discovering ideas from other places. And there should be some general idea about how you use these tools, and they should be blended. And so that's what we're doing in my lab. So one is recent work I've done on what's called a second generation p-value. So p-values are a tool that statisticians have used for a long time to tell people when they think the evidence in the data is strong enough to be taken seriously and you should make a decision based on it. The p-value is widely debated. It has some good properties, it has some bad properties that can be problematic. And so I've developed this idea of a second generation p-value that does what we wish that original p-value had done. And we're currently studying the properties of it. Everything that we look at, it looks really interesting. So we're working on getting that out, and we have a software out for people to use that. So that's exciting. But that's a little bit more on the traditional statistical side. On the data science side, I'm doing a lot of machine learning and sort of blending, well, how can I use these very fancy algorithms that tell me sort of what are the maximal predictive information in the data versus how does that translate over to statistical models that are more constrained, where I know I can learn from them very well, even if the model's wrong, but they don't do a good job as predicting. And so I have a bunch of projects where we're putting these things together. So I know how much I should be able to predict, but I can't get there with this more constrained model. So what can I do to that model to make it better? So that's some of the pieces we're doing. And I'm doing that in the context of a project where we are looking at health disparities for non-white groups in lung cancer screening. And we've done a fair amount of work trying to understand how we should attack these screening guidelines and what is the role of race when you're doing predictions. Does this go in your model? Does it not go in your model? How do you account for it? And we've studied the current guidelines, and we've looked at their properties, and we've made some proposals to make some things more equitable. And a lot of that is trying to understand, using these models to understand how well can we predict and why are there differences between groups and things like that. So that's sort of where I'm doing and still working on that and like it very much. It actually started when I was recruited to Vanderbilt to start their graduate program in biostatistics. They did not have a statistics department, and we had to write, I had to give a presentation to the Faculty Senate about what is it that statisticians do, and then in particular, how biostatisticians are different, and what is our core what is the core contribution? And the words I used were data science to sort of explain that this was, in fact, a discipline that's really interested about questions relating to data. How do you get information out of data? So the words were there, but the concepts and the tools and thinking about things algorithmically instead of probabilistically, for example, weren't there and didn't come along until I was asked to help to get started their Data Science Institute. Several of us were asked to do different pieces. I was asked to start the academic side, which was developing the curriculum and putting together initially a master's program there. And it was me, a physicist, and a computer scientist. And we had to sort of figure out how are we going to teach data science? What is it? And that was a great opportunity for me to get really involved in what was the emerging community. I mean, that was, 2016, 2016, 2015. Those ideas are out and about, and Vanderbilt was trying to respond and think about what it was going to have to offer in that space. From there, I was recruited here. And so sort of have been drifting to a more and more data science-y type environment. I do have a fun story, actually, about an old chess game that I'll tell you in middle school that you just reminded me of. So I used to play chess. I was nationally competitive and have played for a long time, and I really enjoy it. One of the harder things now is finding time to do it, so I don't find a lot of time to do it. The funny story is, in middle school, we had a teacher who used to pick on a friend of mine who played chess and was not very good, and he used to beat him. And me and another friend who were good chess players were in the room when the teacher promised to throw an ice cream party for the entire, it was a group, it was a house, it was a set of classes, if my other friend, Leroy, could beat him. And so we sat up two chess boards next to each other, and Leroy had no chance, but he was gonna try. And my friend and my friend across from me was Tom, we copied the moves. And so we just figured out what the best move for Leroy should be, and then we would make the move. And so we thought this was totally obvious, because the teacher who's sitting right there will just look over and see the game's exactly the same, right? He never noticed. And so all of us together beat the teacher. And he was shocked. He couldn't believe it. And so he decided he was going to throw an ice cream party because he had promised. Eventually, we told him before the party because we felt guilty. And he laughed about it. He had no idea. He couldn't figure out why he lost. It was apparently bothering him for a couple days. But he went and threw a nice big, he threw a great party, actually. And everyone remembers. And Leroy was the hero. So that was our crew. That we had a little chess crew in middle school. A little bit of a nerd. But yeah, that's what we were. And we had a good time. So that's my funny story.